Welcome to Mayo Clinic Sleep Medicine Podcasts, a series for physicians, advanced practice providers, nurses, and other health practitioners treating sleep disorders or interested in learning about state-of-the-art advances in sleep medicine and sleep health. I'm your host, Dr. Michael Silber.
And I'm your co-host, Dr. Maitri Juna. We are both consultants at the Center for Sleep Medicine at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota.
Welcome to our podcast this morning, which is on REM sleep behavior disorder. How does Parkinson pathology evolve? Now, it's well known that middle-aged and older patients who develop REM sleep behavior disorder, RBD, carry a risk of the development of Parkinson's disease, dementia with Lewy bodies, or less commonly, multiple system atrophy. But how does a sleep disorder evolve into a broader neurodegenerative disease? To explain this, I have as my guest today, Dr. Bradley Boeve, Professor of Neurology at Mayo Clinic, who is both a board-certified sleep specialist and a very well-known expert in behavioral neurology. Brad, thank you for coming on the podcast. Many of our listeners are not neurologists, and some of the current concepts of neurodegeneration may be somewhat unfamiliar to them. So let's start off with the synucleinopathies. What is alpha-synuclein, and how does normal synuclein differ from pathologic synuclein?
Great. Thanks, Mike. I appreciate the opportunity to discuss as part of this podcast. So first, you know, synucleinopathy, it's a mouthful. So that's a broad term for the groups of disorders that have alpha-synuclein as its primary misfolded protein. And there's still aspects of synuclein biology we don't understand, but the synuclein protein is typically at the synapse, which is the gap between two adjacent neurons. And it has a normal function that still isn't fully understood, but that's where it's located typically. And then for reasons that we still don't fully understand, something causes that synuclein protein to change and misfold, and it's brought up either the axon or the dendrite. And if it gets into the main functioning of the cell body, that clumping of the alpha-synuclein protein, it forms a ball. And Dr. Lewy was the first one to describe that, and others labeled this a Lewy body. So that's where that term comes from. And misfolded protein in the branches of the neuron, those are typically called Lewy neurites. So Lewy neurites and Lewy bodies are part of Lewy body disease.
Oh, that's wonderfully clear. Thank you. So let's next talk about the Braak hypothesis. How does this hypothesis explain the progressive nature of synucleinopathies that seem to progress symptomatically and pathologically?
Interesting question. And Heiko Braak and his team, they reviewed hundreds, if not thousands, of autopsied material from people who had no symptoms during life, but especially those that had Parkinson's disease. And they then reviewed the aspects of the synuclein protein in the brain, the brain stem, and in the more motor and thinking parts of the brain. And based on that, they developed a staging scheme known as the Braak staging scheme of Parkinson's disease, or of some people equate this with Lewy body disease. And their proposal was that this begins either through the nose, so in the nasal area. More commonly, it's in the brainstem, the bottom of the brainstem or the medulla, and over years, it progressively ascends up the brainstem into the motor and the cognitive and behavioral circuits of the brain. And this evolves, again, over years or decades, so it's a very slow progression, but that's the central Braak hypothesis with regards to the central nervous system. There's other aspects of that for the peripheral nervous system, which I suspect we'll talk about too.
Well, let's just clarify that. Isn't the other aspect of the Braak hypothesis that for at least some people, the conversion to that abnormal alpha-synuclein starts in the colonic ganglia in the autonomic system in the colon and then progresses up the vagus into the lower brainstem rather than from the nose? Aren't both pathways sort of part of the Braak hypothesis?
Right. And this is still to emphasize, this is a hypothesis. And so it's the leading hypothesis. There are some other groups that have variations of this kind of a similar theme. But after the Braak team first proposed this at the brain, they went further steps where perhaps this starts outside of the brain, outside of the spinal cord, so in the body. So, for example, the colon, other aspects of the digestive systems, and or around the heart. So these small nerves that go into the colon and around the heart, and that may be where, in many cases, perhaps in most, maybe not all, but a significant proportion, that's where the pathology of the synuclein begins. And then years later, it comes up the vagus nerve into the lower brainstem, and then ascends into the brain.
Okay, so that's what the Braak hypothesis suggests, but how does this happen? How can the transmission of abnormal synuclein protein from peripheral nerve cells in the colon, or maybe in the heart, or maybe in the nasal mucosa, how can it actually spread up and change normal synuclein in cells of the brain into further abnormal synuclein? Tell us a little bit about the prion-like processes that have been postulated to explain this.
Sure. So first, prion. So prion, protein infectious like material. This was first coined decades ago in the setting of Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. And that's a otherwise sometimes term variant of mad cow disease. And so that this is a different illness. The synuclein disorders is different from Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease or prion disease. But what we learned from that is when the prion protein that all of us have changes shape and misfolds, adjacent nerve cells that are basically touching the abnormal nerve cell then becomes abnormal with that misfolded prion protein in it. And it's a domino effect that all these other neurons that are touching the abnormal neurons then develop pathology from that abnormal protein. That same concept has been proposed for Parkinson's disease or Lewy body disease, as well as some other neurodegenerative diseases, where one neuron has the misfolded protein, and that either goes across the synapse or through some other mechanism to adjacent nerve cells. The normal synuclein changes to abnormal synuclein, misfolding, and again, the domino effect happens. And again, the thought is this happens quite slowly over a period of years or decades, but we have to have an explanation of why do any of these disorders start and why do they progress? And this does just make sense that if a misfolded protein can then interact with other normal proteins in adjacent neurons, this is a reasonable explanation of why these disorders progress.
Great. You mentioned that this sort of maybe we shouldn't even use the term prion-like process, that it's clearly different from typical prion diseases. And perhaps just for our listeners who are not familiar with this, we should just emphasize that there is no evidence at all that Parkinson's disease and related conditions are infectious, or that pathologists who cut into brains with Lewy bodies are at risk from getting Lewy body disease themselves. That's correct, is it?
Exactly, yes.
Okay, so you mentioned that the Braak hypothesis and this propagation of abnormal synuclein, converting normal synuclein, is just one hypothesis of how these complex neurodegenerative diseases develop. And there are certainly some problems with this hypothesis. For instance, not all patients with Parkinson's disease progress in the specific order, starting with peripheral autonomic changes like constipation or orthostatic hypotension, progressing to REM sleep behavior disorder, then motor Parkinsonism, then dementia. We have patients who start with dementia with Lewy bodies with no evidence of any of the other features at the beginning. And in some patients, for instance, REM sleep behavior disorder might develop after the motor features of Parkinson's disease. In addition, in some patients, loss of smell comes first. We've also been able to find abnormal synuclein in the skin and salivary glands of patients who only have isolated REM sleep behavior disorder. How did it get there? So is it possible that in some patients, not necessarily an alternative hypothesis, but a complementary process, is that multiple neurons in different parts of the peripheral and central nervous system, for unknown reasons, start independently developing abnormal synuclein?
Exactly. And this is still going to be hard to prove or disprove, although as advancing technology becomes available, we will be able to better prove or disprove this. So personally, I think Alzheimer's disease has taught us a lot, and that has applicability for Lewy body disease. So for example, most people with Alzheimer's disease, they begin with a memory problem, and they have the amyloid and especially the tau protein in the temporal lobes. And then over years, it spreads to other parts of the brain to develop language problems, sometimes visual problems, executive problems. But some people with Alzheimer's disease, their memory is fine early on, but it's more of a language problem or a dysexecutive problem or a visual problem. And so that concept, I think, applies also to the synucleinopathies. So there may be the common form of the evolution, but either synucleinopathies start in a patchy manner and may be semi-independent from each other, and they coalesce over time, or it is a unified process, but it's so minimal in parts of the body that it never or rarely reaches a threshold to develop symptoms. And so it can be all over the body or in many places of the body, but symptoms relate to beyond a certain threshold. In other words, if you can make a neurodegenerative disorder complicated, Lewy body disease is a pretty good example of a very complicated neurodegenerative problem.
So we really need to try identify what is the initial trigger which starts changing normal synuclein into abnormal pathologic synuclein, and we're not quite there yet, are we?
Correct.
Brad, thank you for making this as clear as possible. In our next podcast, Dr. Boeve will discuss whether it's possible to test for Parkinson pathology in patients who appear to have just isolated REM sleep behavior disorder. So thank you, and we look forward to joining with you at our next podcast.
We hope you enjoyed this podcast. If so, please tune in again through wherever you receive your podcasts as we discuss further topics in sleep medicine and sleep health. Thank you. Thank you.